them for taking the time to bring precious items and place them on the altar. I would ask that you, after service, don't remove them so quickly so everybody can see what you hold sacred and honor the memory of your loved ones. Amen?
Amen.
Today's text is the story of Moses, but it is also the story of the realm of women. For when we talk of babies and women, we enter into a woman's realm, a private world of moon cycles and blood and sheer determination. First, the backdrop of our text. The Hebrew population living in Egypt was exploding. You know, there is might, there is possibility in numbers. And it would appear that these numbers worried the new king. In addition, Egypt had enemies who bordered them. It's one thing to defend your country against an outside attack, but it's quite another to be attacked from the inside as well. Well, the king needs a population control plan. He was worried that the Egyptians would be outnumbered and defeated internally. This wasn't a problem of building better border patrols and thinking of ways of how to prevent them from coming in, for they lived among them. The practice of working enslaved Hebrew men to the point of exhaustion had no effect on controlling the Hebrew population. Rather, it apparently had the opposite effect. For it says in verse 12, the more they afflicted them, the more they multiplied. So this new hideous plan attacked the problem from another angle. Rather than trying to prevent conception, this king's idea was one of unnatural selection. He would select which newborns lived and which died. In this case, it was all the boys, all the Hebrew boys that were to die. Why? Well, the answer should be obvious. The girls could be used as working slaves and presented no real military threat, but the boys, on the other hand, well, they might become warriors. This is the scenario, this is the context Moses is born into. So by all human standards, he never had a chance. Not only was he to be born a slave, but there was already a death sentence upon him. Before he was born, he had no life expectancy, because Pharaoh had declared that all Hebrew boys that were born were to be exterminated, thrown to the crocodiles. I want you to take a moment to consider, who today does our system throw to the crocodiles? Who does this system say does not deserve to be saved? Who does this system say does not deserve to be educated? Who does this system say does not deserve to be protected? Who does this system say does not deserve to live among us? Who do we throw to the crocodiles? But now at Moses' birth, this is where the story changes, and a woman bearing children, Jochebed, women delivering children, Sibora and Pua, and a woman wanting a child, Batya. Exodus 1, the king of Egypt said to the Hebrew midwives, when you help the Hebrew women in childbirth and observe them on the delivery stool, if it's a boy, kill him. But if it's a girl, let her live. The midwives, however, feared God and did not do what the king of Egypt had told them to do. They let the boys live. So even at the moment at his birth, we have some women on the scene in this private women's realm at the birthing stool, changing the course of history. with a quiet, determined defiance. Doesn't say why, except they knew God. I guess we could say these women were Moses' godmothers, for they surely represented the will of God on his life. I wonder what made them defy a national order to go against the king. I wonder what made them decide not to follow the easy road, but to make a hard decision, one that went against the rules of society and the prevailing political climate, and compel them to go with the will of God. Now, I know most of us are not faced with life or death situations today, but I think it's safe to say that there are points in any life where we in our daily assigned tasks stand at a crossroad with a decision to make. Just think for a minute, what would it take for you to follow the narrow, more risky road to do the right thing? I mean, what would it take for you to protect the life of those who are considered a threat even before they're born? What would it take for you to decide not to just go along to get along when evil asks you to collude? So here we have the midwives resisting, and the other person who is not willing to just submit to this climate of oppression and hatred is Moses' mother. A mother without position or fame, but a mother who decided to take a frightening risk. So she builds a little basket and waterproofs it, and his big sister, Miriam, watches him down the river. And this mother's courage saved a nation, for her child would become the great deliverer of Israel. And you know, Moses was her third child. Her firstborn was Aaron. He later became the high priest, and from his family would become a line of priests. And her second child was Miriam, whom is intimately associated with Moses' leadership. She was also a gifted poet and a musician. So it's important to note on this Mother's Day that Moses' mother, Jochebed, raised three accomplished, noteworthy children in slavery without money or protection and as a member of a despised people. Oh, I know some of us know about that kind of determination, born of hard circumstances and humble beginnings, the determination of sacrifice, the determination of just doing what has to be done, the determination of a mother thinking and wanting that her children must do better than she did, the determination that gives courage in the most hopeless situation. So you know the story. His sister stood at a distance to see what would happen to her baby brother. And then Pharaoh's daughter went down to the Nile to bathe, and her attendants were walking along the riverbank, and she saw a basket among the reeds and sent her slave girl to get it. She opened it and saw the baby. He was crying, and she felt sorry for him. "This is one of the Hebrew babies," she said. Then his sister asked Pharaoh's daughter, "Shall I go and get one of the Hebrew women to nurse him for you?" "Yes, go," she answered. And the girl went and got the baby's mother, Jochebed. Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Take this baby and nurse him for me, and I will pay you." So the woman took the baby and nursed him. And when the child grew older, she took him back to Pharaoh's daughter, and he became her son. And she named him Moses, saying, "I drew him out of the water." So now, not only is Moses' life saved, but the Egyptian government will pay his mother to nurse and raise her own child. God works in mysterious ways. This story reminds us all of the mothers who put their children in the belly of the very beast that was created to destroy them in order to save them. This story reminds us that even women in the realm of privilege have a role to play in the struggle for justice. All the women in this story have things in common. First, a great respect for human life. Second, a compassionate heart. Third, the courage to do justice, to love mercy, and to walk humbly. And fourth, a faith that looks for a miracle, that sees the invisible hand of God. The other thing this story shows us is that no one can ever escape the embrace of a loving mother, even after she's gone. Her teaching and training and encouragement serve to guide us on the path we follow. Even when Moses is given to another and being raised in a palace, he didn't escape the embrace, the teaching, the influence of his mother. And we know this because when he saw an Egyptian slave master beating a Hebrew slave, he lost it and killed him. Pharaoh's daughter raised Moses as her own son. She gave him her name, she gave him a great education, and all the wealth and grandeur of ancient Egypt that she was allowed to confer upon him. Yet, Moses refused to become an Egyptian prince. And I believe that's because of the spiritual truths. That's because he knew his mother. He goes on to answer the call on his life to lead his people out from the place of oppression. Scripture tells us that Moses was not willing to put aside the spiritual base or the ties to his people that his mother taught him. For when a mother has a foundation of faith, the family built upon it has a strong foundation. Someone has said mothers write on the hearts of their children what the rough hand of the world cannot erase. I think that quote says it all, that mothers can be disciple makers. They have the opportunity to hand down their faith about God. They have the unique ability to demonstrate what grace and love looks like. They have the first opportunity to inform us who and whose we are. Years later, the Apostle Paul writes about evidence of maternal influences on Timothy, and he says to Timothy, "I have been reminded of your sincere faith, which first lived in your grandmother Lois, and in your mother Eunice, and now I am persuaded lives in you also." I remember the early years that I learned the elementary truths about God. I remember learning about Jesus, that I was loved well just because I was. Jesus loves me, this I know, because the Bible tells me so. And as a child, just seeing the women in my life who did pray, who did charity, who did justice, taught me what it meant to serve God. And their example planted some powerful seeds. Can I just put a pin here and share some things I learned from my mother who's here with me today? My mother taught me critical thinking. If everybody else jumps off a cliff, would you do it? My mother taught me proper health habits. If you don't stop crossing your eyes, you're gonna stay that way. My mother taught me to think ahead. If you don't pass your spelling test, you will never get a good job. My mother taught me to meet a challenge. What were you thinking? Answer me when I talk to you. Hey, don't talk back to me. My mother taught me humor. When that lawnmower cuts off your toes, don't come running to me. My mother taught me metaphysics. Watch what comes out of your mouth. Thoughts do become things. If you keep saying somebody makes your stomach hurt, eventually you'll have a stomachache. My mother taught me how to become an adult. If you don't eat your vegetables, you'll never grow up. My mother taught me about genetics. You're just like your father. My mother taught me about my roots. Do you think you were born in a barn? And the all-time favorite thing my mother taught me was justice. One day you'll have kids, and I hope they turn out just like you. Then you'll see what it's like, and I can't wait. I'm sure you have some life lessons that come to mind as well. I'm sure you share with me the same sentiment that I am no doubt here today because of my mother and her mother and her mother before her. Women of faith, women who championed their community, and women who believed in the sanctity of family. On this Mother's Day, may I suggest to you that this is a heritage, this Christian faith, you owe to your children and your family, God's family. And not just those children born of our flesh. Never underestimate the power that God has given us to mother, to nurture, to correct, to love, to educate, to intervene, to mentor, to advocate for. Well, you might be thinking, yeah, you don't know me. You don't know my situation. I am fill in the blank, too old, too tired, too busy, too aggravated, too sick to mother anyone. You might be thinking, I've got my hands full with my own children. But I want you to consider at least taking a moment to voice your concern whenever you see the powers and principalities of darkness and evil in high places willing to sacrifice certain children for the sake of the empire. Today on this Mother's Day, consider being a midwife so new life can exist. This story tells us that we must always be on the alert to advocate for those being systematically thrown to the crocodiles. The women in today's text, these midwives, his mother and his adopted mother, their combined acts of resistance gave us Moses that led to the freedom of many. We must be receptive to being that midwife as well. What would happen if we saved more children? It could be our saving moment as well. And so on this day, set aside to honor mothers, we honor those who have been the mothers of our faith. We honor those who have been mothers in our struggle for rights and personhood in this country. We honor those who mothered us when our mothers could not. We honor those mothers who have gone to glory. We honor those mothers who, like Rachel in the Bible, weeps because her children are no more. And we remember those who have midwifed us, emotionally, professionally, and spiritually. And also on this Mother's Day, we pray for the children who are not mothered. And we pray that they will be women like Pharaoh's daughter, who although have not carried a child in their womb, will be faithful enough, brave enough, generous enough, to carry them in their hearts just like they were their own. We pray for the children whose mothers can't and won't love them because of their own pain. And this day we acknowledge a God who is a creator that embodies the love of all who mother hope to achieve. That love that passes all understanding, a love so high that you can't get over it, so wide you can't get around it, and so low you can't get under it. Today we acknowledge a God who has used women to be agents of change in history. Today we acknowledge a God who saw fit to make the world become flesh through the body of a woman. We acknowledge a God who, after Jesus was crucified, dead, and buried, appeared to the faithful women and told them, "Go tell the brothers Christ has risen." If that doesn't make you acknowledge the feminine face of the Almighty, well, I don't know what will. So, people of God, when the spirit of destruction comes again, as it always does, and the winds of destruction blows through homes, through bodies, unsettling bones, daring to leave a residue of self-loathing on the skin and the psyche of those marked. And when the atmosphere reeks of agony and distrust and lies stand tall over truth and decorum lay bleeding mocked, know that we serve a faithful God that can use the least of us to be one of the anchors to hold back the destruction. May it be so. Amen. Amen.